It doesn't sound like a news organization. As a matter of fact, it sounds like it's a think tank, the Center for Public Integrity. It doesn't sound like the Washington Post or the New York Times. But it is indeed the oldest and largest nonprofit journalism organization devoted exclusively to investigative reporting. So why is there a need for this kind of journalism? Globalization and development have created extraordinary pressures from polluting industries, crime networks, rogue states, and the actions of powerful figures in business and government. The information and communications revolutions have outpaced the ability of law enforcement to keep up with corruption. The news media, hobbled by short attention spans and lack of resources, are even less of a match for those who would harm the public interest. Over the years, our reporters have exposed smuggling by multinational tobacco companies, a disastrous ATF operation that sent 2,000 guns into Mexico and put them into the hands of the outlaws, new details about Iraq and Afghanistan war contracts, billions of dollars in European subsidies for the fishing industry, lobbying by Koch Industries, and that's Koch Industries as in chemicals, not the stuff you drink, and many other corporations, and even a race car driver who made his millions from payday loans that charge people 800% interest. Here are two stupendous money numbers that you should know about Washington. $3.5 billion is spent on lobbying each year, and upwards of $8 billion will be spent on the 2012 campaign. That's $11 billion to influence Congress, the White House, and the federal agencies. On the lobbyist side of the corruption ledger, it's hard to top the Jack Abramoff scandal. It's so delicious that a movie was made from it called Casino Jack, starring Kevin Spacey. Abramoff was a multi-dimensional corrupt lobbyist. He defrauded Indian tribes of more than $20 million while he was supposed to help them build casinos. He scammed a U.S. territory you've likely never heard of, the Northern Marianas Islands, to the tune of $7 million. He also arranged for 85 congressmen over the course of several years to take trips to the exotic Pacific island while he lobbied them for an exemption from minimum wage laws. Abramoff subsequently went to prison for 5 years, and when last seen, he was finishing his sentence at a halfway house while working at a kosher pizza joint in Baltimore. Then there is the completely legal system of fleecing the government for federal contracts, congressmen who shake down corporations for campaign contribution in exchange for votes, and corporations that lobby Congress and the federal government to bend rules to their favor. I wanted to take a look for a minute at a Tennessee company, Federal Express. I don't know if it's the largest company in the state, but it has a huge presence in Washington. For many years, it had a very low lobbying profile. Then suddenly, it amped up its presence about 5 years ago. It went from spending $3 million on lobbying in 2005 to an astonishing $25 million last year. I mean, you can see on the graph how it peaked up. I didn't dig deeply into the details. I'm not sure why they decided they needed to spend $20 million additional on lobbying, but there's a reason for it. In the Capitol, FedEx has been known for its generosity with its fleet of airplanes. It keeps a couple on standby for lobbyists that need to jet off at a moment's notice. I would guess that there was either an FAA reauthorization bill in play or perhaps some restriction on that particular gift, which congressmen have to report, that sent them into Washington with so much money. So FedEx's $25 million ranks fourth in the nation in terms of lobbying expenditures, behind the Chamber of Commerce and two utilities. Since President Obama took office 2.5 years ago, more than 300 administration officials have moved through the revolving door of lobbying. And of the 120 lawmakers who departed Congress after the elections last year, 39 are now in the lobbying trade. One of them is a congressman from here, John Tanner, a Democrat who retired from the 8th District. He was a founding member of the Blue Dog Coalition, and he was snapped up by the Prime Policy Group, a lobbying firm that brought in $3 billion in lobbying contracts in just 3 months this year. The center's central mission for the 2012 elections is to identify the people and the industries supplying the secret money that will flood the presidential and congressional elections. Our job is to show how money manipulates voters, and corrupts the democratic process. We fully expect the 2012 election to be the most expensive, least transparent, and dirtiest presidential campaign in modern history. Why is that? In January 2010, the Supreme Court issued an historic ruling in Citizens United versus the Federal Election Commission. The Supreme Court ruling said that corporations and labor unions cannot be prohibited from raising and spending money on elections. In practice, the ruling has unleashed a torrent of unregulated money into the political system. And then there are the bundlers. Bundlers are fundraisers who persuade their friends, family, and colleagues to pony up $2,500 contributions to a presidential candidate. And then they bundle those donations and actually clamor for the recognition for doing so. President Bush and Karl Rove invented the practice in 2000, rewarding their bundlers as pioneers and rangers, and every presidential candidate since has eagerly adopted the practice. But after just one quarter of fundraising, that's 3 months, Obama announced he had 244 bundlers who had already raised at least $50,000 each for his reelection. And in that three-month period, there were 25 people who had already roped in more than $500,000, including people like Vogue editor Anta Wintour and Hollywood mogul Jeffrey Katzenberg. Here's what we found. Nearly 200 of his biggest bundlers have landed plum government jobs and advisory posts, won ambassadorships overseas, snagged federal contracts worth millions of dollars for their business interests, or opened their mail to find an engraved invitation to the White House for a state dinner, a 4th of July barbecue, or maybe bowling with the first family. Solyndra had a $535 million loan guarantee from the federal government. The primary investor in Solyndra was an Obama bundler, George Kaiser. The center broke the story about Solyndra in May, when the company went bankrupt, putting thousands of people out of work overnight. The loan guarantees took on a life of their own because the taxpayers, many of you in this room or your parents, basically guaranteed that loan and are now on the hook for it. We've been putting in Freedom of Information Act requests for White House and Energy Department communications about Solyndra, and the details are slowly dribbling out. We've devoted the full-time attention of two reporters this year to investigate what the bundlers got in return for their financial largesse for the Obama campaign. We would do the same for the Republicans if they would release the names, but short of that, we're compiling our own list, which will take weeks, if not longer, to try to figure out who is giving the most money to the Republican candidates. Two election lawyers have told us they believe the Citizens United ruling has opened the door for foreigners to launder unlimited, undisclosed money through the 501c4s. As elections watchdog Fred Wertheimer told us, foreigners are prohibited from making direct contributions to the candidates themselves, but they could give money to the 501c groups and no one would ever know because these donations are not disclosed. There is currently no federal regulatory process monitoring this possibility. Your junior senator, Bob Corker, he has four fundraising events scheduled this month alone. He's up for re-election, which most of you know, and he's already raised $9 million to run. Over his Senate career, Corker's top three PACs have been these. Pointer Management has contributed $70,000 to him. J.P. Morgan Chase, a big New York bank, has donated $70,000. And FedEx, the hometown boys, are not far behind at $65,000. He gets just 2% of his campaign contributions from small donors, people like business owners and people who work here on the campus. More than half of his money comes from PACs and individuals that max out at $2,500. I will say this for Corker, 80% of his money comes from Tennessee. That's not true of a lot of people running for office. When Bill Frist was Senate Majority Leader, Congress decided to build a $600 million visitor center. It's in addition to the Capitol. The backstory is that lawmakers didn't like the long lines of hot, sweaty tourists that snaked around the Capitol. So they built a little $600 million monument to themselves to channel the tourists through the basement. And guess where the marble on this floor comes from? Remember, Bill Frist was the majority leader. So $9 million worth of gorgeous pink stone from Tennessee now adorns the visitor center. A spokesman for the Capitol Architects said, there really aren't a lot of options for pink marble in the country, and we do have a Buy America clause. The Center for Responsive Politics focuses on money spent on lobbying and on campaigns for Congress and the White House. Their website is opensecrets.org. It's easy to use, and you can check up on your members of Congress or look up lobbying data for corporations in your community. The state-level counterpart to Open Secrets is called the National Institute on Money and State Politics. Its website is called followthemoney.org. You can check up on contributions to state legislators, as well as governor and other statewide offices. You can also track lobbying spending at the state level, including up here in Nashville. Each state has its own laws governing campaign finance, so followthemoney.org has really done a public service by putting all of this information together in one place. And another group I'd mention is the Sunlight Foundation, which you can find at sunlightfoundation.com. It tracks everything from government waste, fraud, and abuse to something that they call Party Time, which tracks fundraising parties for lawmakers and presidential candidates, and which is where I found out that Bob Corker is having 4 fundraisers this month. So these groups are just the tip of the iceberg, but they're a good starting point and user-friendly. So I encourage you to use these websites to do your own research to follow the money and keep track of what your lawmakers are doing. Thank you.